Hey guys, welcome back. So in the last video, we hooked up our DC side and we hooked up our solar. Now it's finally time for the big test. We're gonna see if everything works. Let's get started. We're gonna turn on each inverter one by one and test the panel to make sure the panel's wired properly. Then we can connect the data communications cable and program the inverters for split phase. All right, so we got the battery hooked up and we should have current to this breaker right here. But we do not wanna just turn this breaker on. This inverter needs to be pre-charged. This capacitor is inside the inverter, and if you flip that breaker, going to get a massive inrush of current and it's going to be slamming your inverter, so it's not good for the inverter. You want to use something like this. This is a pre-charge resistor. This is a 100 ohm 10 watt resistor. You can buy these at AutoZone. We're going to connect it from this terminal to this terminal. It'll allow power, a little bit of power, to flow around the breaker and slowly charge up those capacitors inside the inverter. So we're just going to connect to this terminal here and I connect this one up here. Nothing really happens, but you give it about 10 seconds or so. And we should be good to go. Look at that, output is 120 volts. So the inverter is actually putting out 120 volts. Let's check the panel. Okay, so remember when probing a live panel, always wear protective gloves. This is live voltage here. So right now we should have power to the breaker, so we can flip the main breaker. And since this inverter on the left should be feeding the panel or the bus bar on the left, we should have power on the left bus bar. So we're going to probe from this plug here over to the neutral over here. Actually, it doesn't matter what neutral. It's actually this neutral. So we'll just put one here. Put one here. We should have 120 volts across those two terminals. And there it is, 120 volts. So that's actually cool, it's actually working. If we probe from this bus bar to this neutral here, we should not have anything because that bus bar is powered by the other inverter, which is off. Nothing. So that's cool, we got power to our left bus bar. And we should have power down to our outlets down here, which is this breaker here. Let's test that. Okay, so we're just gonna put our probes inside the socket here and we should get 120 volts. First, we gotta turn on the breaker. And there it is, 120 volts. So these outlets should be working. 1600 watt heat gun. Check it out, it actually works. That's so cool. Now this inverter powers these outlets here. The other inverter powers these outlets here. So we will not have power here until we power up that inverter and flip the other breaker. We got 120 volt output, good. Okay, just like before, we should have power to the right bus bar coming from the right inverter. So let's turn on our main. Okay, and there it is, 120 volts. There it is, 120 volts. I love these 20 amp circuits. They power anything. It's working. Awesome. Okay, so the inverters come with this data sharing cable right here. That's for the communications and the synchronization of the split phase. And it also comes with these current sharing cables. We're not going to use these. You would use these if I duplicated this whole system. So if I had two more inverters down here and parallel the inverters, we would get a parallel output. So 54 amps plus 54 amps, 110, 108 amps using these cables. So we're not going to use these, just the data communications cables. Okay, so the data communications cables are these DB15 right here. Cables, and they're serial cables. I think it's RS-232, not really sure. But anyway, those two connect to that inverter and it runs along here and it connects to the other inverter over here. You really can't mess them up. One goes in one goes in the other. That's all you gotta do. Okay, so per the manual, this is configuration item number 28, AC output mode. This inverter is gonna be the primary inverter, so it'll be set to 2P1. And the other inverter will be the secondary inverter that'll be set to 2P2. There's a bit of a trick when doing this. If you just go into the menu and then go down to item number 28, when the inverter's on, you can't configure that particular item because it's dealing with the phasing. So you have to actually turn the inverter into standby mode, and then it frees up that item, and then you can go ahead and do that. First, you're going to hold enter. That gets you into the settings menu. Go down to item number 28. Okay, 28, hit enter. Now if I try to set it, it won't let me do it because it's locked because the inverter's on. So we're gonna hit power to put it in standby mode, and it'll free up this item so I can configure it. And now it's in standby. Now we're gonna go 2P1, right there, hit enter, and then escape. If the setting is proper, it'll say 2P1. That's it, we're good. Okay, now we can set the second inverter for 2P2. Standby, don't forget standby. It'll be 2P2, 120, and 2P2, 180. You want 180. Hit enter, and escape. It's gonna error out because the other inverter is not on. But you really want to make sure it says 2P2 here, so we're good. All right, so don't forget to set it to 2P2 180. 120, you'll get like some weird voltage. It won't be 120. So remember, 180 degrees between the phasing. Right, we should be able to turn both inverters on roughly at the same time, and we should get 220 volts. Let's see what happens. It's making some noise. Okay, 2P1, 120 output, and 2P2, 120 output. I think it's working. Let's test the panel. Remember before, we tested this lug to this lug, we got 120, and this lug to that lug, we got 120. Well, if we go from this lug to that lug, we should get 240. There it is, 240 volts. Check it out, 240 volts, awesome. Let's test the plug down here, turn on our 50 amp breaker. There it is, 240 volts. Unfortunately, I don't have anything to actually use with this 240 outlet now, so I'm not gonna use it. But hey, everything's working, how awesome is that? Okay, load test time. I got 4,500 watts of inductive loads connected to both outlets. We're going to see how hard it hits the battery. Currently, we're using just half an amp to run these inverters at idle. So let's fire everything up and see what happens. Heat gun, heater number one, heater number two, all on high. Hundred amps on the battery. That's actually not bad at all. 4,800 watts of power. We're only hitting the battery for 94 amps. Look at that. Just 93 amps on the battery. That's crazy. So the primary inverter is at 36% load, and the secondary inverter is only at 21%. So these things have a lot of room to go. We're powering a lot of stuff here. I mean, this is over 4,000 watts of power right there. This is a 48 volt system. To power 4,500 watts of load on the AC side, it took around 100 amps. If you want to power the same load with a 12 volt system, for example, you would use 375 amps on the battery. That's a dangerously high level of amps to be running. So yeah, it's amazing how much fewer amps you need on the battery side when you're basically running a higher voltage battery. So keep that in mind. From going from a 12 volt system to 24 to 48, every time you double your battery voltage, your amps will basically be cut in half. But before we go, a very important point. These inverters are quite old. They're newer inverters now, specifically the EG4 6000 XP. I can't put a video out without mentioning that because basically it's 240 volts in one box. So you don't need two inverters. You don't need a program split phase, none of that. You put the box on the wall, If you need more, you just keep adding more. You can have 1, 3, 5, 7, any number of inverters you need to meet your power requirements. So definitely take a look at that before you decide going like a dual inverter setup, because this is kind of a, it's kind of being an older setup now. So I think everyone's kind of moving towards those new all-in-one boxes that do 120/240 in a single unit. In fact, if I were to do it again, I'd probably use those units myself. They have a lower storage capacity, so you'll probably need at least 2 to match this system. But yeah, it's really convenient. And the breakers, all this stuff that you see outside here, this breaker, the breaker for the solar disconnect, the main DC battery disconnect, it's all built right in the box. So you're actually saving money by buying those units, because you don't have to A, mess with the wiring, and B, mess with thinking about what size breaker do I need and everything, because everything's rated for that unit. Well, I think that's it for the 48 volt garage build series, and those who follow along up until this point, I greatly appreciate it, and by now you should have the knowledge to build your own system. So thanks for watching, and I'll see you on the next one.